I'm going to look at, if you want to turn there, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Let's look at it again. For the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless, I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Being a courageous Christian. Being a courageous Christian, you know, one of the things, we're entering at a point in time where the world is experiencing some difficulties and problems. And we see it happening all around us. In fact, probably at an intensity level that there's some that are saying that World War III has started. We recognize, and whatever you want to label them, but we recognize that a lot of the terror and a lot of the murderous rampages are being caused by Muslims. You can call them Islamic terrorists if you want, or whatever terminology you'd like to refer to, but they are responding, they are doing these things based on an ideology. An ideology is a belief system that they hold. And it's a belief system that they are willing to sacrifice everything to see advanced. Obviously, they're willing to sacrifice their own lives. In fact, they have training where they're basically suited up in suicide vests. In fact, just recently, over in, was it Belgium or France, one of the two, they had raided a group of them, and a woman had blown herself up wearing a suicide vest. And we see suicide bombers happening on a regular basis. Now, one of the things that we need to glean out of this, because it will help us as we deal with this issue, is the fact that there is no deterrent to this ideology. This ideology is not deterred by the threat of violence. They are not deterred by the threat of imprisonment. They are not deterred by the threat of someone killing them or even killing their families. They have an ideology that presents itself in such a way that if they are faithful to it, their belief system, their ideology, if they are faithful to it, that they will receive rewards after this life. How many of you are acquainted with that? You'll see some of those things that they talk about, you know, getting wives on the other side or in heaven, or experiencing these various pleasures that await those that are killed, advancing this particular belief system or ideology. Now, in one sense of this, it is one that should really be challenging us as Christians. Because there are Christians that do not sacrifice and are unwilling to make the same level of commitments to their ideology as these Muslims are to theirs. And in a sense, that's a shame. Now, Paul, in his letter to Timothy, writes these words in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. He says, For the cause, I'm willing to suffer these things. For the cause, I am willing to suffer these things. Now, he is saying something along the same lines of some of these Islamic terrorists, at least from their perspective toward their ideology. For their cause, they're willing to suffer. For their cause, they're willing to sacrifice. For their cause, they're willing to commit their entire life, their entire focus, their entire efforts for the advancement of their cause. Their cause represents their purpose. Their cause represents their reason. Their cause represents the essence of their ideology. Is everybody with me on this? And so for their cause, they are willing to suffer. And what Paul is saying here, and this is something that I really want to challenge you. He is saying, for the cause of Christ and His kingdom, I am willing to sacrifice. I am willing to suffer. I am willing to give myself. I am willing to make a commitment because I've got a cause that overrides any personal desires, pleasures, or interests. I have a cause that supersedes all those things to the extent for the cause that I have, I'm willing to suffer. Everybody seeing that? Yeah. What does that imply? There's a quote from a fellow by the name of Lauren Wolf. He says, courage rises when the cause is greater than the circumstance. Courage falls when the circumstance is greater than the cause. Everybody grab that? Courage rises when the cause is greater than the circumstance. Courage falls when the circumstance is greater than the cause. If you have a cause, if you have a purpose, if you have a reason for your existence, that is the foundation stone of your ideology, you're willing to forsake all of your personal interests. You're willing to suffer for the advancement of that cause as it is a reason for your existence. And when you get to that point in your life where you recognize the fact that your cause, your reason, your purpose is bringing glory to God and living according to His principles and advancing His kingdom, you can say with Paul, for the cause, I'm willing to suffer. For the cause, I'm willing to suffer. Now, there's some here, and I would suggest that probably most of you at least would say it, whether or not all of you would do it or not. Most of you would say it, that if someone were to break in here, Muslim terrorists or whatsoever, and say that if you're going to say that you're committed to Jesus Christ, if you're going to say that you're going to be walking with Jesus and committing your life to Jesus Christ, you are going to be assassinated. You're going to be beheaded. I would suggest that most of you as Christians would make the statement that I'm willing to do it. I'm not going to deny Christ. No. Okay. Okay. Hopefully they're not going to the same place. But the bottom line is for the cause you'd be willing to say that. Now the thing is that Muslims, did you know that there's a call to prayer on a daily basis? How many of you know that? And they will take that because of the cause, because of their purpose, because of their focus, they will take a certain portion of their day and they will go and they will bow toward the city of Mecca. In fact, I think in some circles it's 5 times a day. The prayer bell or however many times. But they will go when they hear that prayer bell and they will go to their knees and they will face Mecca. I've seen Muslims doing that in Missouri just on the side of the road. Actually at a gas station. It was the time of day, and they were in a journey. They stopped, they got out, they laid their mat down, they focused toward Mecca, and they prayed toward Allah. This is a cause. This is a purpose. This is a reason for their existence. This is so much a part of them and so much a part of their ideology. They are willing to suffer. They are willing to go through any kind of sacrifice necessary to see their cause advanced. And yet sometimes we, as Christians, who have a cause that is
the difference, of course. Our cause is just. Our cause is real. Our cause is powerful. Our cause is the fact that we know beyond the shadow of a doubt that we've been created for God's pleasure. We've been created for the advancement of His kingdom. We've been created to promote His kingdom and to see His kingdom extended. And yet there's times when we won't pray at all, let alone five times, seven times, however many times a day, that they're willing to stop and make a commitment to prayer. We don't pray at all. There's individuals today that says, yes, I'll allow my head to be chopped off, but you're not even willing to suffer a few minutes of the day to read your Bible. You know, we can talk the talk, man. I mean, we can all say the right words. But how many of us are putting it on the pavement of life? How many of us are really at that point in time where we recognize we've got a cause that will allow us to suffer? We have a cause that will supersede our own interests and our own pleasures and our own desires. Why am I getting up in the morning? Why am I going to church? Why am I committed to Bible study? Why am I committed to prayer? Why am I committing to making the Bible a daily part of my life? Because I've got a cause. I've got a cause that allows me to suffer. And there's times, I really don't believe that the suffering that we go through by sacrificing a few hours of sleep or sacrificing a television program or sacrificing these things is of any great huge sacrifice, the suffering that we would go through. But the suffering that Paul's implying is the fact is that I am willing to forego these personal desires if indeed they conflict with my cause. And so he writes to Timothy, and you see these things going all around us, and there's people that are thinking, you know what, all we need to do is be kind, all we need to do is torture them, all we need to do is bomb them, all we need to do is, and you know, we're gonna get rid of all these terrorists, we're gonna threaten, you know, we're gonna nuke you, we're gonna arrest you, I'll tell you what, they have a cause that's greater than the fear of all of those things. That's the truth. They have a cause that they're willing to die for, they're willing to commit their lives to, they're willing to kill others for. They have a cause that is just so permeated into who they are. It is so essential, folks, that we get that same level of commitment to our cause. The cause of Christ, the cause of His kingdom. It says, for the which cause I also suffer these things. I go through these things, I experience these things in my life. But then he goes on in that same passage and he says, nevertheless, I am not ashamed. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. And what he's talking about there is that he's not disappointed. He's not discouraged. He says, for this cause, I have this cause in my life. And if you read some of Paul's letters, in fact, we're studying one right now to the Corinthians. We're studying 2 Corinthians right now in Bible study. And we were reflecting on that this morning, where Paul says, you know what? I'm called as an apostle, and he was drawing a comparison, and he says, I really believe that I have the right as an apostle, as someone called of God, to be funded by the people that I'm sharing spiritual truth to. I really believe I have the right to receive funds for care for my physical being because of the ministry that I'm in. But I don't want people thinking that I'm in this for money. I don't want people thinking that I'm in this. So this is what I'm committed to do. I am going to support myself while I minister. I am going to commit. I am going to sacrifice my own interests to raise the funds so that I can continue to share the gospel with you. Those of you that were there this morning, we read that, didn't we? We read that in 1 Corinthians, as to what, or 2 Corinthians, what Paul was sharing there. He says, you know, I'm not like some of the other disciples that are taking around their families and their wives. I mean, I've committed my whole life to this, and I've committed my whole focus to this because I've got a cause that supersedes everything and anything in my life. And then he writes this to Timothy along the same lines. He says, you know what? I've got this cause, and I'm willing to suffer for it. I'm willing to experience sacrifice and sacrifice myself for it. But let me tell you something, I'm not ashamed. I am not disappointed in the commitment that I've made. God has fulfilled my life. I don't consider any of the sacrifices or any of the sufferings that I've gone through, I don't consider them a mistake. I am not ashamed. I am not disappointed because I know, as we read that in its entirety, he says, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. I am not disappointed, for I know whom. Hallelujah. I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Right? And so what Paul is saying is that I have this cause that's based on Jesus Christ. I know him. I have a relationship with him. I don't have a belief that he exists. I don't have just a belief that he cares. I don't just have a belief that he went to the cross and he rose again. I don't just have a historical knowledge. I know him. I know him. And it just gets down to that point when you personally have that relationship with Jesus himself to the extent that you can say, it's not someone I believe in, it's someone I know. I know him. I talk to him. I've experienced him. I've received him. I know him. He's in my life. He's the focus. He's the center of my life. Anybody relate to him in that way? When you get to that point where you say, I know him, all of these things that you will suffer because of your commitment, all of these personal sacrifices that you make, you don't regret them. I give the example, of people's attitudes. It's like, hey, do you want to go to? Hey, we're having a big party tonight, man. We're gonna go. We've got all kinds of. We've got a few kegs. We're gonna get really wasted. We've got a big party going on. You want to go? Gotta serve God. With a disgusted look. No, I can't have fun. I'm making this sacrifice that I just can't. Can't enjoy myself. I'll probably go home and read the Bible or something. You know what? No, it's just like, no. No, I don't need that. I don't need that. What you're using to get you high will get me low because I'm already far higher than that'll ever get me. I'm willing to suffer these things, and it's not a huge sacrifice. I'm not ashamed. I'm not disappointed about it at all. I'm not looking, no, I can't go. No, I don't want to go. I don't want to participate in that. I don't need to participate in that. Because I have a cause that I'm not ashamed about. I'm not disappointed about. I'm committed to. Right? I'll tell you, when you get to that point, and whatever it may be, when you get to that point where the world wants you to sin, the world wants you to violate God, the world wants you to become part of the world and do the things that the world is doing, you just get to that point in your time, you just say, no, even though my flesh, the longings of my carnal nature, the longings of those things within my flesh, it wants to do those things. Your flesh wars against your spirit, Scripture says. Your flesh cries out, to do those things. But, you just basically, cut it out. Shut up, flesh. You're basically saying, no, I'm not going to submit to that. In a sense, my flesh will suffer, but my spirit will rejoice. My flesh will be kept in subjection, but my spirit will exalt itself in the Lord. And Paul demonstrated this, didn't he? He's writing this to Timothy, but more importantly than the words that he's writing was the life that he was living. And he demonstrated, you remember back several years ago, you know, whether or not it was done in the way that I've heard, but they said Winston Churchill was to come over and to share a commencement address at a graduation service at a university. And it was after World War II, right after World War II, and he stood up and he gave a speech that gained a standing ovation, and his speech included, never give up. Never, never, never give up. Never give up. And he went and sat down. That's all he said, according to tradition. And the whole university stood and gave him a standing ovation. It wasn't the words, never give up. It was the tenacity. And the fact that the UK would never give up. England would never give up. You know, they would, in spite of the Blitzkrieg bombing, in spite of all of the attacks that were going on by the German Air Force, he made that decree, we're never going to give up. And so when he gave that speech and they gave that standing ovation, it wasn't the speech, it was the man behind the speech, right? It had substance, it had character, it had integrity, because that's exactly what he portrayed. Someone that never gave up. When Paul said this, when he says, you know what? I am not ashamed. I am not disappointed. Timothy can receive that, not just necessarily because of the words that he's sharing, but for the lifestyle that was portrayed behind those. Classic example of this is when he and Silas were apprehended. Do you remember that? They were apprehended and they were beaten. And then they were put into the dungeon and chained up down in the dungeon area. In a Philippian jailer, you remember that, in Philippi, a Philippian jailer was watching over the jail, and as they were there, and here Paul and Silas, and I can almost hear Paul talking to Silas. He says, you know, for the which cause I also suffer these things. But you know what? I'm here in this prison. I'm here in this dungeon. I'm chains on my body. My body's just been beaten. But I'm not ashamed. I'm not disappointed. I don't regret it one bit, because I know whom I have believed in. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Amen. If Paul said that, and you know what, as he said that to Timothy or Silas at that particular time, as he said those words, portrayed those words, he began to praise the Lord. He began to sing praises to the Lord in spite of his conditions, in spite of his sufferings. And we recognize the fact that God showed himself powerful. As Paul honored God, God honored Paul. The chains fell off. He was freed from his imprisonment. The Philistine jailer and his family, Philippian jailer and his family, came to know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. Isn't that exciting? But it's all because Paul had this cause that he was willing to suffer for. What's your cause? What are you willing to suffer for? What are you willing to... There's some people that aren't willing to suffer for a whole lot of anything. There's not a whole lot of causes in life. In fact, there's some that would say along the same lines, you know, I pictured this in my mind back when my kids were small. If someone were to ask me, you know, would you what would you do if a lion attacked your kids? And I say, you know what? They might find their dead daddy there next to the lion, but they'd find pieces of the lion in the daddy's mouth. Lion's ear or something. You know, I would do what it took to protect my children. And then I picture, well, what if a train was coming, and you know, and there was only time to just jump in front of the train and push your kids off the tracks? What would you do? And that's, you know, they'd probably find me in a couple pieces. just to save my kids, I'd give my life for that. And I pictured it along those lines. And then it's, well, what about, you know, Mark talking to me, God talking to me? You're willing to give your life and sacrifice your life in death. Are you willing to sacrifice your life in life? What about when Seth says, you know, will you go outside and play ball or catch with me? Or when Adam would say, you know, Dad, can you take me to the store? Or Heidi, you know, Dad, can you come to my dance recital? Or some of these things, you know. It just gets to the point where, you know, now I'm watching a football game. You know, ask me some other time. Maybe I'll do it tomorrow or something. No, I've got something else going on or something. Sometimes we're that same way. We're willing to die. We say we're willing to die for Jesus. We're willing to give it all for him. We're willing to chop off our heads or do whatever's necessary. We're going to take a stand for Jesus. We're willing to sacrifice our lives in death. But how many of you are willing to suffer in life? It's not what you're going to do when the Muslims come or whoever comes and says, you know, if you don't deny Christ, we're going to chop off your head. It's today, Sunday, November 22nd. You know, what are you willing to do today? Are you willing to suffer? Are you willing to set aside your own interests, your own desires for his kingdom? One in which that you're not disappointed in doing because you know him. Amen? You really get to know somebody. There's not too many people here that, you know, wouldn't fight Goliath with their bare hands to protect their mother. Right? I mean, it doesn't matter. No matter what it is, if something's coming after your mama, you're going to do what it takes. You're going to stand up for her. You're going to fight for her. And, you know, it just gets to that point. Why? Because you know her. You love her. You have a relationship with her that you're willing to sacrifice for. And, you know, we got to get to that point where we know Jesus, where we really know him. Not just what Pastor Mark tells us, or not what we read about, or not what we're going to do on Christmas. And, you know, okay, he was born and laid in a manger, and, you know, wise men, different things, you know, came. You know. Hey, we know the stories, but not just knowing the stories about knowing him. In so doing, you're going to have a cause, I believe, that you're willing to suffer for. I don't have any disappointment because I'm fully confident, Paul says. Not only do I know him, Jesus, whom I believe, but I'm fully confident that he's able to keep me and my commitment right until that final day. I am so confident of this. I am so confident that my commitment, my dedication to him, he is going to strengthen me and he's going to keep me right up until that final day. And this is it. I'm giving my life for this, my whole life. He demonstrated. What an example. What an example that I fall short of, that Paul gives us, doesn't he? But how important it is for us to recognize these things. We want to make an impact. You want to make an impact on Muslims. You want to make an impact on an ideology that individuals are willing to suffer and die for. It's so real to them, and you, it's not real to you. You're not really sending them a message. You know, the message needs to be our God, our true God, our God that manifested himself in his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, is one I'm willing to commit for, is one that I'm willing to live for, die for, and reflect my entire life. And it's real and it's powerful. And I'm willing to suffer for that cause. I'm willing to make the commitments necessary to portray him. I don't know if it's just, of course, it's hard to ask a fish how the water is, right? Because the water is all a fish knows. So he doesn't have anything to compare it to. So it's pretty hard to ask a fish how the water is. It's pretty hard for me, being raised here in this Western culture in the United States, to dissect it from an external perspective. But I would suggest that our Western culture in which we live is very passive, and it lacks levels of commitment that other cultures have demonstrated and have been imprisoned for because of the fact that they were willing to stand up for Jesus Christ, and they were willing to suffer, and they were willing to make commitments, and they were willing to make this the integral part of their life in spite of the consequences and difficulties that they faced. Within communistic regimes, within hostile regimes, they continued to stand up for Jesus Christ and proclaim him. They continued to read the word. There's individuals that the word was so precious to them, and the Bible was forbidden in their country, that one Bible would be snuck in and then it would be passed around and they would memorize it. They would memorize the whole Bible because they couldn't have one. And they knew it had to be passed around, so they needed to memorize as much as they could while they had it. Was it difficult? I imagine it was. Was it a challenge? Yeah, it was. Were they disappointed that they did it? Not at all. They considered it a joy and an opportunity to be able to get the word in their life on a regular and daily basis. Here in the United States or in our Western culture, we have you can go down and buy any kind of version of the Bible you want. Bibles are very, you can get it on tape, you can get it on CD, you can get it on DVD, you can watch it, you can do whatever you want, and yet those individuals that are memorizing it and sacrificing just to make it part of their lives, when it's very easy to make it part of our lives, we don't do it at all. Or hit or miss, or just small chunks or small pieces every now and then. And it just doesn't seem as though that the cause is as great to us for some reason as it is to some other people. Do you see that too? Because when the cause becomes great, the courage becomes great, the sacrifice becomes great, the suffering becomes great, we're willing to do more, we're willing to commit more, we're willing to be who God wants us to be. I would say this, it's not just you, well, I need to read more, or I need to pray more, or I need to go to church more. It's not just saying those things. Those are superficial if it's not from your heart. And it'll quickly dissipate. You can turn over a new leaf today and say, yeah, from now on I'm going to read the Bible more. And guess what? I'll talk to you 6 months from now and the Bible's dusty sitting on the shelf. You had good intentions. The problem's not that. The problem is you need to know the cause. You need to know your purpose. You need to know the reason for your existence. And you need to know him whom you have believed. You need to know him. And when you get to that point, you get to that point in your life, nobody has to twist your arm. Nobody has to ask you to do these things. And you're willing. Your commitment is your own. It's not mine. It's not anybody else's. It's your own. It's a commitment based on who you know. Are you with me today? Paul said, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Let's pray.